Hello, and thanks for tuning in tonight to Answers for the Paranormal on a frigid Friday night here on the East Coast of the United States, February the 9th, 2018. My name is Bill Posey. I'm your host for the broadcast tonight. On the line with me over in his office in Horsham, PA, is my co-host, Joe Marodi. What's going on tonight, Joe?
One of my three offices, Bill. I've got my guest room, and I've got my basement room, and I've got the Wawa office. I'm in my guest room office tonight. What's going on? I'll tell you, we got a great interview tonight, a great opportunity to shed some light on this paranormal craze that we're still in the middle of, and we're going to come at it from a unique perspective from someone who has been involved with this in the secular realm and also now in trying to warn Christians against paranormal investigating. So tonight is really something that I've really been... When you booked Dana, Bill, and I started looking into Dana's testimony and where she's coming from, I was really looking forward to this, and this is going to be a very good show.
Yeah, amen. I'm excited about tonight. Our guest has been someone who, you know, I've conversed with at times on Facebook. Never had the pleasure. I've never had the pleasure to speak with Dana live, so I've been very excited about tonight and getting the opportunity to speak with her. And she's blessed me so many times in our communication. So yeah, I think tonight's going to be the kind of show that, you know, as you say, Joe, we've never really come at it from this perspective. And
right.
You know, after 10 years or 8 years now, I think it's long mm-hmm. overdue, don't you?
Absolutely, yeah. And it's a we go into a lot of different areas, Bill, but I think that this is really our bread and butter. This is why the Lord brought us to this ministry eight years ago.
You've been thinking about starting your own.
Not to say that, you know, he wasn't leading us into other areas as well, but getting back to this is something that I think that the Lord has really been impressing me with, and I'm sure impressing you with as well. So it feels good to get back to where I think that we ought to be focusing on.
I agree, Joe, and you know, one of the other things that we've kind of struggled with lately is getting the opportunity to produce broadcasts. You know, the last time we were on was on Christmas morning, and here we are in the getting to the middle part of February, and so, you know, it's time for us to get back to it, as you say. So I'm really glad that we have this time tonight to be on with Dana. So with that, Joe, why don't you introduce our guest for tonight?
My pleasure, Bill. Dana Thompson Emanuel is a former paranormal investigator who now exposes the deceptions inherent in the investigative field. Her blog, Exposing the Enemy, can be found at www.exposingtheenemy.com. She is co-author of An Open Letter to Christian Paranormal Investigators. A believer in the finished work of Jesus Christ at Calvary, Dana has a real heart and passion for leading others to Christ. And with that, it's my pleasure to welcome Dana to Answers for the Paranormal. Dana.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you very much, Joe and Bill. I'm very happy to be on your show, and it's an honor to be on your show. I've listened to your show for quite a while, and it's actually helped me a great deal. I always love the subjects and everything, and the good thing is you're helping lead people to Christ. That's the most important thing. And like I said, thank you very much for the opportunity.
Yes, amen.
Fantastic.
And, we're so blessed tonight, Dana, to have you on with us. And, you know, as Joe and I were talking this week about having you on, and as we were developing questions, it was funny that Joe says, okay, Bill, here's my questions. What are yours? And I'm going through his questions, and I'm like, well, I have that one. I have that one. It's almost like we had the exact same questions for you. So we decided,
oh, wow.
Okay, we're just going to go with
Bill. After 8 years, I think we're thinking a lot alike.
Yeah. It's scary sometimes.
<That's good.
laughs> So, Dana, it's, you know, with that kind of spirit of like-mindedness that that we're on with you tonight, so that makes the blessing even more special. So,
amen.
You know, we are so happy to have you with us. So,
thank you so much.
Yeah, sure. You're welcome. So, Dana, I thought we would start out tonight with your testimony about how you came to know Jesus Christ as your Savior.
Okay. Do you want me to go ahead and start?
Sure. Mm-hmm. Fire away.
Okay, thanks. I was always interested in the paranormal, you know, when I was a kid and, you know, watching scary movies and things like that, you know. Even, you know, when I was a teenager and we'd have sleepovers and, you know, we'd always play games like Mary, Mary, you know, in the mirror and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
But I just always loved any kind of movies that was related to haunting or exorcism, things like that. But this fascination of mine, it actually turned into more like a quest, wanting to know more about the afterlife once I actually experienced paranormal activity of my own. I had an incident that happened. I was living with my grandmother. She had Alzheimer's, and she was in the late stages of Alzheimer's. She was bedridden, and she was in a fetal position, so it was total care. My grandfather, however, he passed like 18 years prior to this. And when we moved into the house, you know, I did hear from family members, you know, granddaddy still watches grandma, you know, be careful, you might hear him at the night time, and, you know, and all this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Which, you know, at the time, like I said, I was just fascinated with this stuff, but I didn't really know to believe it because I had never experienced anything. So we started hearing noises. Mm-hmm. They were right. We kept hearing footsteps and stuff over by my grandmother's room. We would hear stuff going on in the kitchen, and it even would get so loud it'd wake us up. But it would always stop, you know, after you wake up, it would stop. So you think, well, maybe I'm dreaming, you know. But one night, it was going on, and it was so loud, it woke me up, and I didn't open my eyes. And I kept laying there, and I was wanting to look, because I kept hearing it. And where we were sleeping at was in the old family room in my grandmother's house. We made it into a master bedroom, and it was across from the kitchen. So I could see into the kitchen from where I was at. Mm. So I heard it again, and I'm like, okay, I was scared, but I opened my eyes, and I seen the chair move, and it was the kitchen chair to the table set. And when that happened, then I got scared, and I ran outside of the house because there was a side door that went outside from our room, and I went out there, and I was upset, and my husband come out there, you know, what's wrong, and I told him what I seen. And he's like, calm down, it's okay. Because I was like, I'm moving out, I'm not going to stay in there, you know.
Sure.
There's something there. And so he assured me it was probably my grandpa. So I, you know, I calmed down, and I thought, well, you know, it's not trying to hurt us. You know, we just hear noises, and maybe he is just looking after my grandma.
Mm.
You know, so in a way, it kind of gives you a reassuring feeling, you know what I mean? Especially when you think it's someone you love that's passed away, you know, you don't. Your first reaction isn't to make it leave. You just, you know what I'm saying? You feel empathy. You want to allow it to be there. You know, you just think, well, it's not going to harm anything. So anyway, after this happened, I got curious about the afterlife because I thought, well, is this grandpa, you know? Mm-hmm. I had always went to church, but I would go for a while and I'd stop going, you know. And I would go holidays. I wasn't really serious, though. You know, I didn't read my Bible. I wasn't studying my Bible. I didn't listen to the sermons. I didn't, you know what I mean? I was always just there with my dad, and I just didn't pay attention that much, you know. And I thought I was safe. You know, I didn't think that, you know, anything would be wrong with going out ghost hunting or anything. So we started going out to the local graveyards and, you know, things like that at first. The very first night I went out, we actually got an EVP, and it was at the first grave that we were standing at the beginning of the cemetery. And the EVP said, when I asked what's your name, it said Frank. And I didn't know it at the time, obviously, you know, not till we went home. And that first night, I also got an apparition on a picture. Well, when you get this, it's fascinating, you know? Mm-hmm. You're like, wow, look at this. You know, everybody's awed by it, you know? So the next day, after we heard the EVP, I was talking to my daughter, and I says, you know, we should go back, because that was at the beginning of the tape. That's when we first started recording, and I can remember where we were at. It was right at the beginning, you know? So we went back there to see. Sure enough, the gravestone, it said Frank. That was the first name. Mm. So then I was like, wow, you know, I mean, it just was so intriguing. I mean, you know, it seemed like the more evidence we would find, the more we got hooked into it, you know?
Yeah.
You're driven by that, you know, the evidence and you know, trying to get that evidence, you know? So anyway, after I got into it really good and everything, we had some serious stuff start happening in our house, and it was like, my husband was getting attacks. He would be like, he told me that he dreamed of like a woman with red hair came to him and was trying to seduce him. Mm. And he told me about it, and I was like, oh man, I started looking up stuff about it and everything. And I was like, oh my goodness, it might be like a demon or something, you know? Mm-hmm. So I told him what I thought, and I guess he started questioning it, and I guess it got violent with him. One night he woke up and he was yelling, in the name of Jesus, get out of here. You know, because he was like I was. He believed in Jesus. He just wasn't a Jesus follower, you know?
Yeah.
Right.
So he started, you know, rebuking it and everything. And at this time, it had got so severe, I hung grocery beads over all my doors, my windows. I mean, I had Bibles open in every room thinking that this was going to help, you know? But it's actually when we apply it to our lives. It's not really just the open Bible that gets
right.
rid of anything.
Amen.
And so he was yelling in the name of Jesus and everything, and the beads on that necklace just popped in midair. And so after this happened, it left. I mean, it stopped for the night, and he realized that he had bite marks. It was in his groin area. And he was just, you know, I mean, we was like, oh my goodness, you know. Well, we had a couple things like that happen that it just, and one night my grandson was in the bed. This was when I was like, okay, I had to draw the line. And I was so desperate at this point. But my grandson was in the room, and me and my husband, he lives with us. My grandson does, mm-hmm. or he did, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, he was in my room watching TV, and me and my husband was in the living room, and it was quiet in there, so something told me, check on him. So I came in the room, and I looked at him. Well, he was sitting up on the bed, looking at the foot of the bed, like he was scared to death. And I was like, what's the matter, Pa? What's it? What is it? And he said, I don't know. And I said, well, what is it? What is it? He said, I don't know. He said, I think a monster or something. And I said, well, I don't see no monster. I said, there ain't no such thing as no monster. You know, I was just trying to calm him down. I said, where's the monster at? There's no monster in here. Well, he jumps off the bed, and he looks so confused, and he's looking all around on the floor, and he swept his hand across the floor, and he said, I don't know. He said, I think it went in the floor or something. And when he did that, I knew that, well, he was telling me the truth. I mean, he was only like 3 or 4 at the time. And I'm like, I was so angry because I was like, you know, that whatever it is, it was messing with us. But now it was appearing in front of my grandson. And I'm like thinking, what's it going to do to him? You know, I was so afraid, you know. So I was like, okay, this is it. Now, mind you, this is a big gap I'm talking about, because when I started in the paranormal, it was like at least like 15 years. Until I got to this point, you know.
Oh, wow.
But it was a long time, you know, but I'm just trying to get through how I got out of it. So anyway, when he did that, I told my husband, I said, look, I said, we have to do something. I said, we need to get you a deliverance or something, because I kept hearing, well, maybe a spirit attached to me and it attached to him, you know, like maybe during an investigation or something, that maybe weren't attached to me or something. Mm. And, it, you know, like I said, I brought it home or something. And so he was like, okay, I'll do it, whatever you want to do, you know. So we had, I bought an audio book, and it was Chip Ingram, and it was called, I think it's called The Invisible War. And I was playing it on my laptop at night next to the bed. And I was like, okay, you know, I was just listening to it, and I fell asleep. Well, on that audio, there is deliverance prayers on it. So we fell asleep, and it was still playing. Well, my husband, you know, something come in the room, and he could feel it. I mean, when it would come in the room, you would know. You would feel it. I mean, it was like we would be on the bed. Mm-hmm. At one time, we was laying on the bed, on each side of the bed. We had a king-size bed. And literally, we thought that my grandson had came in the room, got up on the bed between us, and, like, was wiggling his way between us. And I reached back to pat him on the back. He wasn't there. I told him, and I said, oh, my gosh. And my husband turned around and said, what? He said, Buddy's not here. He said, I thought that was Buddy. I said, so did I. You know, so it was like things like that would happen, and it was just, like, so dark. I mean, you could just feel the darkness in it. It was the evil, you know? Mm-hmm. That feeling you get, you just don't understand until you go through it, you know? So anyway, back to when I was listening to the audio, we fell asleep, and my husband had woke up because he felt something. He felt something bump the bed. Well, he was like, oh, my God, you know? So he was trying to think, what do? You know, well, then the audio was saying a prayer. So right away, you know, first instinct, he's like, well, I'll just say the prayer, you know? So he started saying the prayer along with the audio. And all of a sudden, the fan in my room went, bam, it went across the wall, into the wall. And I woke up, and my husband, he shook my shoulder, and he's like, Dana, cut that off. And I said, what? He said, well, whatever it is, it don't like it, just cut it off. And I'm like, and I'm hearing the prayers, you know, and I'm like, you know what, I don't care what it don't like. And I said, get out of here in the name of Jesus. And we started yelling and for it to get out of here, you know. Well, it did, it left. But, you know, it would always come back, you know. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And we couldn't figure out why, because I'm thinking, okay, I'm using the name of Jesus. Why isn't it going to leave me, you know, why does it still keep coming back? So, anyway, I took my husband to a church, and I after the service, I walked my husband down, and we talked to the assistant pastor. And I told him, I said, look, I said, we have something in our house. And I said, it keeps attacking my husband. I said, I think that on one of my investigations, I brought something home and it attached to him. And he said, what are you talking about? And I said, well, I'm a paranormal investigator, and I think that, you know, I brought home a spirit out of someone's house. And he said, oh, honey, you got to stop doing what you're doing. And I said, what do you mean? And he says, well, that's the occult. He said, you can't be doing that. You know, the stuff that's associated with that, you can't be doing that. He said, that's probably why these things are happening. You know, he said that you have an open door, you know, to the demonic because of it. And I was like, oh, wow. Well, it's just for some reason, it clicked in my mind. I was like, gosh, maybe he's right, you know. I just didn't put that together, you know, before. I didn't think there was nothing wrong with what I was doing. And so then he looked at my husband, and he says, why do you have that on? Well, my husband had on rosary beads. I mean, we had them, like I said, you know, we were trying to do everything for protection.
Yep.
And he was wearing them, you know. So, and my husband said, well, for protection. And I told him, I said, yeah. I said, we got them all over our house. You know, we've got Bibles open in every room, but it's not working. He says, please take that off. And my husband took it off. And we looked at each other. We were confused. You know, like, why would this preacher tell us to take off a cross, you know? And he says, well, he says, you have to know something. He says, when you're putting your faith in an object, you're taking your faith off Jesus. It's Jesus and him alone that's going to give you freedom. And when he said that, oh, man, it hit me. I was like, my gosh, no wonder. I was just thinking that the name of Jesus wasn't enough. You know, we had to get this, we had to get that. You know, I mean, we did all kinds of things. I was even doing, like, burning sage, because you hear all this in the paranormal community. You know,
sure.
It's so many different people in it, you know, with different religions.
Yeah.
And to be honest, it's like, in the paranormal community, syncretism is huge. I mean, they're truly just mixing all the religions. Like, they'll go to one house. If this house believes in the shaman ways, then you get a shaman to come in, or you burn sage. You know what I'm saying? If the homeowner is a Wiccan. You burn sage or you put salt out, you know, and you do all these things. You know what I'm saying? But none of that works. The power is in Jesus. It's not in these other things, you know?
That's right.
When he prayed for us, oh my goodness, Bill, Joe, I was sitting there, and as desperate as I was to bring my husband there to get the deliverance and to get this stuff out of my house, I kept feeling like I had to get out of that church. I just got this sudden feeling of panic come over me, and I was like, oh my goodness, why am I, you know, I couldn't even understand why I was feeling that way, but then it clicked. My gosh, I have spirits. It's not me. You know what I mean?
Yes.
I really felt that it was like the manifestation of both worlds. It was like the preacher was praying for us, and the power of God was coming over us, and the spirit was panicking. Mm-hmm. And it was like I just automatically, because I didn't want to run out. You know what I mean? I was so desperate. I'm like, you know what? I just have to have faith in Jesus and just rebuke it in Jesus' name. And I just kept saying the prayer with him. Even if it is, just leave me alone. I, you know, just leave in the name of Jesus. And I kept saying it. And all of a sudden, that feeling I had, it literally just broke. I mean, I remember the second. I remember how it felt. And it felt, oh my goodness, Bill and Joe, it was a freedom. It was like my blinders were taken off. I literally could see everything for what it was, you know?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Like before, I just didn't know. I just kept thinking, you know, well, maybe I'm not doing this right, or maybe I'm not doing that right. You know, well, maybe I'm not doing my cleansing prayers at the house before I leave. My husband kept telling me, well, maybe you just need to say the prayers there before you leave, you know, because he didn't know anything about it.
Mm.
And I was like, gosh, I mean, we tried everything. But it was like when he said that, I was like, my goodness, it was almost like I was at a point where I was ready to receive the truth, you know?
Yes.
I feel like that a lot of times it has to be where someone's at the point of desperation in order to receive it, you know?
Mm.
They have to want it, yes, but they also have to get at that place, just like James 4 talks about, you know, we have to become humble and you have to submit yourself fully. I mean, at that point, I was like, no matter what, I had so much equipment. I had all kinds of, I had my CCTV camera set. I had IR cameras. I had all of my meters for my group because I had my own team. You know, I had so many. I could just go on and on with the stuff I had. You know, we had our own ghost boxes. Mm. We had, well, a Ouija board. We had crystal balls, pendulums. We had so many things, tarot cards. All this stuff, but it was like all of that didn't matter no more, you know?
Yes.
It was like I thought, I don't care how I do it, I just got to get rid of that stuff, you know? Well, the thing about it all is, after he prayed for us and we just totally got set free of this thing, we went home. I didn't even get rid of the stuff right away because the cameras and stuff, I put it on, I think, Craigslist and stuff to sell it, because that's stuff you can get rid of, mm-hmm. you know, with other, of, you know what I mean, that's not necessarily associated with the paranormal. So anyway,
right.
I had not got rid of it right away, but you know what? We never had it again. No more problems. It was literally because we didn't fully submit to Jesus, and we weren't fully trusting and having faith in him. You know what I mean? In order to have the authority over these spirits. And after that happened, I did not have to come home and pray over my house. I mean, it's nothing wrong with doing that, but it truly just all stopped. And I praise God for it.
Amen.
I had my brother and my mother was praying for me, you know, the whole time I was in it. And they kept telling me, Dana, these things you're talking to is demons.
Mm-hmm.
And I just didn't, my brother would even show me Bible verses, you know, like in Leviticus and Deuteronomy.
Mm.
And I was like, I just somehow didn't think it applied to me, you know. I kept thinking, well, I'm saved, it doesn't matter, you know, I'm forgiven, it doesn't matter if I am doing it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of believed in, like, hyper-grace, you know, once saved, always saved. You're not going to be in jeopardy, you know, if you do these things. And I also just didn't know if all that was true. You know, a lot of people take the Bible and they use it like multiple choice or something. You know, they want to believe in the promises of God, but they don't want, they want to disregard, you know, the negative things.
Yeah.
But these things do apply to us, you know, they really do. And if we're a Christian and we go and do things or start getting into something, we will get chastised, you know.
Yes.
We will be under a curse for it. I mean, things will start happening, you know. And people just don't understand. I hear a lot of people say, you know, which can be true, too. But they'll say, well, you know, I must be doing something, right, because I have all this stuff happening. Well, that's not always the case, you know. Sometimes it's because we are doing stupid things.
Yes.
You know, that there's just sometimes we do have something going on in our life that we, you know, need to repent of and submit to God and start trusting in Him and forsake all this stuff, you know. But, so anyway, that's pretty much how, I got out of it and got delivered.
Wow.
So I'm sorry.
How long, Dana, were, you know, the events that you described, particularly with your grandmother and your grandfather, prior to that, how long had it been that you were involved in paranormal investigations? Is that what really led you into paranormal investigations, to actually form a specific group?
Actually, it was like me and my kids. We would go out and go to graveyards and, you know, things like that for a while, a couple years, you know. Well, then it was on TV a lot. Actually, to tell you the truth, there was a show on, and it was like in 2007, because my grandson was born, and I'd get up in the early in the morning and be feeding him and start watching it, but it was Dead Famous. Do y'all remember that one with Chris Fleming? It was him and a woman. I forgot her name. It was called Dead Famous, and what it was these ghost hunters, and they would try to contact the spirits of famous people. You know, like Elvis or Michael Jackson, or, you know, I forget if it was even him, but it was just some like famous people that had died.
So that's one that escaped me.
Yeah, Joe.
That was one that really truly got me hooked. But at the time I loved that show. I wouldn't miss it for the world, you know, when it was going on.
Wow.
But you know, ever since then, and I got my first computer about that time too. And when I got my computer, I started meeting people like on MySpace, and you know, people that were also into the paranormal. So we went to a couple meetups. There's this website called meetup.com, I believe. And we had met some people that were paranormal investigators and stuff, and we would meet up with them, and we met other groups and everything. And do you have a minute? Or do you
sure.
have another question for a few minutes? Because that way I can go ahead and elaborate on this one thing that really had a lot to do with my getting hooked.
Yeah, no, I think that's crucial to understand. Yeah, but no, go ahead.
Yes. After I got my own team up, prior to that, I did start with another team, and I ended up being general manager of that team, and we were with them for a couple years, and then I decided to branch off and start my own group, because I kept accumulating equipment, and, you know, I started talking to people at my workplace and everything, and they were, like, wanting to join my team, and so we had our own team, and we went on an investigation with the other group. Actually, there was three groups involved in this investigation. It was in Palm Bay, Florida. And what happened was there was a guy that lived there, and he was having cases where he would get thrown, okay, into the wall. And, well, what happened is when it happened, he went to the hospital, and he told the doctor what happened because it hurt his back. And the doctor sent him over to Circles of Care. It was for mental evaluation and observation. Well, while he was there at Circles of Care, he told one of the nurses, you know, what had happened. Well, it just so happens the nurse that he was talking to was also into the paranormal, and she believed him. So she gave him a card. It was like a business-type card for another paranormal group that we knew. And she called us while we were actually at another investigation, and she called us. And a couple of the team members, decided to go on over after she told them what happened, and that, you know, she didn't have the time for that case because she was wrapped up doing, you know, some other cases. And so we were like, okay, yeah, we'll take it. You know, well, we always were drawn to the more severe.
Bill?
Yeah, I'm here.
Can you hear Dana? I can't hear her.
No, I can't hear her. Sounds like...
Okay, I'm sorry. Where did I leave off? I accidentally pushed the mute button.
Okay.
Sorry about that. How long...
No problem.
Where did I leave off where you heard me?
Pick up right where you thought you left off.
Okay, we went... we got a phone call about this other... this guy. And, you know, he was being thrown and everything. And
right.
Did you hear where I told you? Okay, I didn't know how far back.
Yeah.
So anyway, a couple of the members went over that night to do like a preliminary and talk to the family that was over, that was at the house, and to get a feel of what was really going on and stuff, and schedule the full investigation. So they went over there and they did some EVP, you know, recordings and stuff. And while they were there, there was a younger girl. When I say younger, she was like 16-ish. That started to talk to some spirit that they believed it to be a little girl. And while she was talking to this spirit, suddenly she started to manifest as if she was the spirit. Well, she went into the closet, into the bedroom, in the closet, and started sobbing and was acting like she was afraid of her father. Okay, so, you know, the way everybody thought that it was maybe this, you know, little girl that was being terrorized by her father, that was, you know, just, it was so confusing, you know. So anyway, they went over there and everything, so they scheduled the investigation for the following week, because by that time, the young man that was getting thrown would be out of circles of care. So we went there the next week, and we're bracing ourselves, because we're thinking, wow, this guy's been being thrown. I mean, he was actually put in the hospital, you know. And then the EVPs that our team members got was saying stuff like, get out now, all of you, you know, and things like that. So we thought, okay, it might be demons, you know. I mean, we believed it could have been earthbound or demons. We believed in all that, you know.
Right,
so,
right.
We went over there that next, you know, week, like I said, and we sat in the van and we prayed. We were actually praying to St. Michael. And we're like asking him for protection and all this stuff. And we went in the house. And as we started to go in the house, me and, you know, the other lady and my daughter were praying. And we were praying like over every door, anointing it with oil, you know, because she had got some, one of the other team members had got some oil and brought it. And was praying over all the doors, and I mean, over everything, you know. Well, one, actually, it's weird, because one of my other team members, which was one that really loved to provoke things, you know what I mean? He was getting upset at me, and he was like, why are y'all praying and stuff like that? He said, man, we don't want you to leave. We want to play around with it. You know what I mean? And I'm like, these people are being tormented. They need to get rid of it. And he's over here mad because we're praying, thinking that it's going to get rid of it before he gets any kind of evidence. You know, and I'm like, you see what I'm saying? People don't really care, you know what I'm saying? They just want to see something happen.
Yes.
And so while we were there, we put the cameras up through the house and everything, and we, you know, had EVPs going and stuff. And what we were mainly doing was a couple of us investigators would go in at a time, and we would use dowsing rods, and we would do dowsing rod sessions. And what that is, you know, for anyone that doesn't know what they are, they're L-shaped rods, and you hold one in each hand, and usually it'll have, like, it'll be covered on the handles with a wooden tunnel type of thing, handles, and what it would do is it would allow the rods to sway freely right or left, you know? So we would hold the rods and we would ask questions. Well, first we would establish at the beginning of every session, what is my yes? And it would sway right or left, you know, close in or go outwards. So what is my no? And then it would do the opposite. So we would know, okay, well, that's our yes and no, if, you know, when we ask the questions. So we would go in there and we started asking questions. And we were getting so many different ridiculous answers that it just stuff really didn't even line up. But a couple times we would ask questions, we would have a door open. And then it would shut when we would ask another question. So, I mean, it was... there was a little bit of things happening, but nothing too severe at this point. Well, then later on, it got late, and the young man, he had left for the afternoon to give us time, not the afternoon, but the evening, to give us time to go in there and do what we had to do. And when he came back, he was asking us, you know, what had happened that, at this point. And we was telling him, you know, that it wasn't really much happening. Our answers we were getting weren't very consistent. We didn't know, you know, really what we were dealing with. And so he says, well, he says, if you want, he says, I can go in with you because whatever it is, it seems like it targets me. And I'm like, yeah, I mean, we were hesitant. We were like, gosh, I don't know, because he got hurt before, you know, and everything. And we didn't want that to happen, but we were like, well, because he basically lived there. He was like the best friends with the daughter that lived there, so he was like always over there. So we went ahead and let him go in with us, and it was me and my daughter. We sat on the bed, and my his other investigator, he was across from me, and he had the dowsing rods, and then the young man that, you know, like I said, was getting a real bad physical attacks, and he was in there. So he started to ask questions, and the dowsing rods would open and shut, and they were answering. But the investigator that was asking the question started provoking it. And he was like, are you afraid of, you know, I'll just say Dan, because I don't really want to say the real name on here, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So he says, are you afraid of Dan? And it would say no. And then he says, well, are you afraid of me? And it would say no. And he's like, well, why don't you come out now? And he says, let me kick you, you know. And he started really provoking it. And about that time, well, Dan started joining him with that. And he was like, you're scared, you're scared. Now, mind you, this guy, he was like 7 foot tall. He was very tall, this young man was. He was probably around 18, 19-ish, I'm thinking. So when he was saying this, oh my goodness, all of a sudden, he asked him one more time. He says, so, you're afraid of Dawn. And about that time, the rod started opening up, and one of them come almost all the way back. And when it did, literally, all of a sudden, we heard BAM! And I was like, now at the time, I was holding a camcorder, and I was recording what the answers were. I was watching the dowsing rod. And we heard this loud bang, and honest to God, it was so loud, we thought something hit the outside of the house. It was that loud, like a loud smack. We didn't know what it was. I said, and I'm like, what happened? And I turn on the light, and this guy, instead of facing us, he was facing the other way on the floor, laid up against the wall. His head hit. There was a file cabinet that was catty-cornered there with a wall. His head hit that filing cabinet, and there was a dent in it. Mm-hmm. And he was there, and we were like, are you okay? Are you okay? And everything. And he was like, he just all of a sudden just started crying. And we were like, oh, my God, we started yelling for everybody else to come in there. Well, it was taking a few minutes for them to come in. And we're like yelling, you know, come on in here, you know. And about that time, finally, they started coming in, and they were like, oh, my gosh, what's going on, you know. Well, I didn't really notice it at the time until later when I was watching the footage. I didn't even put it together at the time. But what had happened, the reason it took a few minutes for them to come in there was at the same moment that Dan was thrown, the grandmother was thrown off the front porch. So whatever it was, it did all this all of a sudden, like, it was like an explosion. I mean, you know, seriously. And yeah, it was like, I mean, when we realized that, we were like, whoa. I mean, we were just, and we were all sitting around in shock and talking about it, and they got Dan and took him out of there. And needless to say, I mean, as scared as we were, because, you know, to the other investigators, you want to act tough. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
It's like you want to make sure and not run. You want to be the one to stay there and not be afraid, you know? So we were like, well, are we going to continue? Or, you know, and I was like, well, I mean, I guess so. And so we literally, well, the guy that was doing the dowsing rod and the guy that was throwing left the room. And so me and my daughter stayed there. Now, I was at the time telling her, get out. Just go out there. I don't want you in here, you know. And she's like, Mom, I don't want you. I'll just stay here with you. And I'm like thinking, well, okay, she's right here with me. She's right behind me, you know. And all of this. So she stayed. And then the girl come in there. And the girl kept saying she wanted to stay in there. And I was like, look, you really don't need to be in here. I mean, look what just happened, you know. I mean, I was afraid for anybody to be in there, really. I shouldn't have even been in there. But it was like we were in shock. We didn't know what to think, you know. And so anyway, a couple of us, like I said, we stayed in there. We started doing some more EVPs and everything and trying to see what would happen. No one would touch the dowsing rods. We didn't do that. But the girls started that looked like she was starting at manifesting. And when I was recording, we were watching her because the way she was just getting real quiet, and she wasn't answering us, and she would, oh my goodness, I'm getting chills thinking about it because it was like, it was so evil. I mean, whatever it was, it was possessing her is what it was doing. Because you know that's what happens when someone channels a spirit. It's literally a demonic spirit that's took over the driver's seat, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So she was sitting there, and she started just looking very strange and not answering, and just my, the other investigator that was in the room with her, he started to leave the room, and we're like looking at him, and he was even on the video. You can even hear us like, where are you going? What are you, you know? And he was like, well, I'm going to go out here. And we're like, well, what is it? Because he didn't want her to hear what he was doing. And I'm like, well, where are you going? You know? And he says, I'm going to go out here and get some holy water. And I was like, oh. And then we're like, wait a minute, don't leave. You know, because, I mean, we were so scared out of our minds, you know. So what we did was we called on the cell phone. My daughter did. She called somebody that was outside. And she said, at the time, she says, Joe, will you please bring holy water in here? And about that time, that girl looked at her, and she put her finger over her mouth, and she was shaking her head no. And honest to God, she looked so evil when she did that. I mean, it was almost like her face just looked, I mean, even on the video, it looked like it. She just didn't look right. She just didn't look right. And when he came in there at this point, me and my daughter was so scared. We were scared out of our minds. And he came in there with the holy water, and we're like, okay, well, we're going to go out here, and you know, you want to stay in here? you want to stay in here? So he just ended up staying in there. Me and my daughter got out of the room because, I mean, but nothing else as far as physical stuff happened that night. But it was after that case and what we seen, and I knew then what these things can do. I mean, it's no joke, and it is biblical. I mean, if you don't have authority over these things and you're playing around with it, you most certainly can get physical attacks. You know, people don't believe that, but, yes, you can. I mean, like I said, all these years that I was messing around with it, that never had happened. You know what I mean? So I just didn't know that it could happen. But it did, and it can happen. You know, and like I said, when you're doing these things, people think, well, I'm saved. So it can't happen to me. You know, I've accepted Jesus, you know. That's not true, though. I mean, if you're doing that kind of stuff, you're leaving his umbrella of protection. You know, you're the one that's putting yourself in harm's way, you know. And not just that, you're putting your family in harm's way, you know.
Right.
I mean, I can't even believe that I had my children involved, you know.
Well, Dana, let me ask you this: as a result of what you were just explaining, it sure sounds like there was a lot of chaos that was going on within these investigations. Are there guidelines that paranormal investigators follow? If so, where do the guidelines come from? I mean, is it just you get there and you follow your senses, or is there some sort of protocols that you got that you paranormal investigators would follow?
Truthfully, we got our guidelines from other investigators and books.
Like
other investigators that we would meet, other groups and stuff, and we would talk about it. We would watch shows on it. I used to have a blog talk. It was called Blog Talk. Right? Have you ever heard of that? What was the name of it? Blog Star. We had a Blog Star show, and back then, and what we would do was we'd have people come on, and we would have them, you can actually see them on the video, and we would all interact, and we would discuss cases and the paranormal and all this, and we would always exchange ideas, you know, the latest equipment, you know, how errors that other people made that we, you know, can learn by, you know, safety tips, things like that. But as far as, like, guidelines, yes, we did have things that we would always try to go by. Like, say, for instance, making sure we had permission from the property owners or tenants to conduct the investigation. We would always try to make sure we had waivers. We would try to have waivers signed in the event that if anyone were hurt or anything like that. We would always make sure we do a preliminary investigation before the actual full investigation. so we could interview people that lived in the home to go ahead and get the information on what they had witnessed, what kind of activity was taking place. We would always also make sure and do a walkthrough in the daytime to check thoroughly for any possible safety hazards or, such as like tripping hazards or possibilities of weakness in the structures of the home that we would have to look out for. And we would also have our own guidelines on how to conduct certain techniques, like, for instance, when conducting EVPs. We would always make sure that when we turned it on, we would say, this is Dana, we're at the Putnam Hotel, I'm in room, on the sixth floor, it is such and such time, and I'm laying my recorder down. I have so-and-so with me, and so we have so many people in the room. I mean, I try to include all information possible.
Right.
That way, if there was something picked up in the background, it would explain why. But those kind of protocols and stuff we would go by, they weren't always strictly followed. Like, say, for instance, the waivers. If it was like someone we knew close to us and we would go to their house, we didn't really, make it something that we had to have, because we would trust them and they trusted us, and we just, would do it that way. But there was definitely guidelines. And honestly, if you go to like the bookstores or at the library or even online now, but you can look it up and you would always find, and they're always not exactly, but a lot of the groups actually have a lot of the same guidelines, because that's where you look for your information, when you're in it. You look for the information from other groups and stuff, and it's almost like a generic list of stuff that, we always try to do. And we always wanted to make it look as much professional as possible,
Because
we didn't want to go in there looking like we were just there for the thrill of it or that we wanted to see anything. It was always, and that's another thing with these, with the paranormal groups, and I don't say this at all, like to demeanor anybody or put them down at all, because I was one for many years, and I was deceived. No one is beyond being deceived, because just like in Revelation, it said Satan who deceives the whole world. So at some point in our lives, we're always going to be deceived. So when I say these things, I don't mean to say it out of disrespect for paranormal investigators by any means, because like I said, I was one. But it's just stuff that they don't understand, and but a lot of them do get into it because of the thrill. They really will act like, oh, well, I'm just doing it to help these people and all this stuff. But, if that was the case, why don't you do it during the daytime? Mm. They want to do it at night because that's when it's thrilling. That's when they, it's spooky. What I'm saying? It's like
you just want to be able
to enjoy and have fun. There's nothing more they want to do, and I'm saying they because it's most, than to be locked down into the scariest place, I mean, I remember many days we'd go down the road in some country, like we'd go to North Carolina because I have family up there, and we would go along the road. I'd see an old empty house. I'm looking around trying to figure out who owns it so I can go in there and get some stuff.
Dana,
was there
a place that you would advertise your group so people could find you if they were experiencing certain things in their homes? Like how did people contact, or how did they know to contact you? Dana, you there? Joe?
I'm here, Bill.
Oh, okay.
I'm here. I think Dana hit the mute button again.
Oh, my goodness. I'm so sorry. The screen is terrible on my phone.
You got put a piece of tape over that mute button. Put some weight out on it.
Right? I'm telling you, goodness. But, oh, goodness, I lost track. I had a website. Yeah, I did have a website. It was called deadtimeparanormalinvestigations.com. It was really long. And because we had a big banner made up because I would go speak at conventions and stuff and show that footage, of that guy when he was thrown. And what I would do is I would actually be a guest speaker, but my what I would talk about, believe it or not, was safety and ghost hunting. Ghost hunting, safety, and spirit communication. I would teach how to, like with the dowsing rods, I would show how to use them and how to you know, contact spirits and stuff, and I would, you know, talk about safety hazards and stuff, which is silly because, I mean, there's no safety in it. You're not really being protected, you know. Right. Sure. You might think so, but not really. God's the one in control, you know, especially if these demonic spirits want to do something and have a legal right in your life, you know. If it's going to happen, it's going to happen, you know.
Yeah.
But
Dana, how many investigations would you say that you performed, your group?
Oh, gosh. Ooh, we did a lot. I wouldn't even know to tell you the truth. I mean, we've done a lot.
Over 100? Under 100?
I would say probably, I don't even like putting a number on it, truthfully, because I wouldn't even know. I mean, it's not like 1,000 or anything, but... because we went to several places several times, like Casadega Spirit Camp. We went there, gosh, like 5 or 6 times. We went to the Putnam Hotel like 3 times. We went to Ann Stevens Bed and Breakfast, and it's over there by Casadega. We went there overnight. We did the Slater House in Casadega. We did that place. We did, Titusville Playhouse. We did that place like 4 or 5 times. We did, you know, private homes, like I said. We went to St. Augustine. We did a lot there. You know, the fort and all this.
Fort.
You know, any route that we could. Go ahead.
So let me ask you this based on that answer. I would guess that there's a prevailing thought out there that people who call paranormal investigators are superstitious. They're people that, you know, private homes. But it sounds like that you were called out by a lot of businesses. So this is, you've got activity that is... Yeah, go ahead.
Most of the businesses was actually, it was places that were popular and rumored to be haunted. We would go there because we wanted to go. Mm-hmm. And... like in the Putnam Hotel and stuff, they would literally let us set up cameras anywhere we wanted to in the hotel because it wasn't that busy. They actually closed down like the year after I got Deliverance. That was kind of weird. I didn't even know it. I just actually found that out not that long ago. That's in D-Land, Florida. Very strange, you know, that happened. But they were letting people come in there and go. So I would be like any different than anything else. Like if you... are involved in occult activities in your home, you're going to probably have a lot of problems in your home. Mm-hmm. Well, if you let this stuff go on at businesses and everything, I wouldn't think it'd be any different, truthfully. Mm. You know?
Yeah. Now, Bill and I have been doing this for since, what would you say, Bill? Well, I mean, we started talking about this back in about 2004, but we didn't officially get into the Christian paranormal ministry until about 2010, and we had always wondered how what course the paranormal craze would take. So you probably have a better handle on this, Dan, than we do. Do you think that the numbers of these actual organized groups, both secular and Christian, these paranormal investigating teams, are on the rise, or is it leveling off, or is it dwindling? How do you see that playing out now?
I honestly going to think that it has absolutely been skyrocketing. Of the media and the fascination. People are getting into it. And I also believe that it also has a lot to do with the church's, you know, lack of knowledge of what it can do, you know, and what the Bible says about it, or refusal to preach. I think there's a lot of contributing factors there, but I do believe that it is on the rise more than ever.
Wow.
I really do.
I don't know whether to be surprised by that or not, Bill. I guess I'm not because, Dana, Bill and I, you know, we're always discussing the latest programs that come on television, and surely that is a lot of the exposure that these new programs present to the population, and it piques interest. It continues to fuel interest in the supernatural, which has always been there. But as you said, Dana, because of the media outlets, it's not really a surprise to me. So that being said, let's get into the real gist of tonight. Now, you were part of a manifesto that was written up by three people, including yourself. Would you explain how that came to be, why it came to be, and who else was involved?
The author of it was truly, it was Mark Hunneman, and he has a genuine passion, for the lost and for people that's getting involved in the paranormal and everything, and always trying to, and in a very humble way, trying to reach out to people and tell them the truth. And he wrote that book called Seeing Ghosts Through God's Eyes. And I actually have the book, and I've had it for a while, and I've never had something that contains so much valuable information on the paranormal as far as looking at it through the lens of the Bible, you know, the biblical worldview.
Yeah.
And it's a very good book. But anyway, he has a heart for the lost. And also Laura Maxwell, she has our spiritual quest. She was also into the occult for many years. Her and her mother both, they were spiritists, and her mom, I guess she was a medium, and which it was awful. They were getting attacks, and her mother was suffering attacks and everything, and very sadly to say, her mom ended up losing her life as a result of this torment that she was going through and the oppression, you know, that these spirits would put her in. And so she, as a result, she's really been doing a lot of work putting out, reaching out to people, and she has an awesome website, too. It's, like I said, ourspiritualquest.com, and she also has a radio show also. It's called, oh my goodness, she's going to kill me. I'm trying to think of it.
Your Spiritual Journey?
Well, Eternity? Oh my goodness, I don't believe it.
That's okay.
I'll tell you what, you can find it on her website, though.
At the end of the program, we'll come back to that. Hopefully, we'll get to.
Yeah. But anyway, he Mark came up with this really awesome idea, and he wanted to write up a manifesto, and it's kind of like where it's a plea to a group of people that's into something, and it's another group of people that's playing with it to change something or do something. And it's actually geared towards the paranormal investigators that are Christians. And it's trying to plead with them that it is against the Bible. And when they go in there and they think they're going to do deliverance or whatever, that it's not the proper way of going about it. And it also subjects the client in more further, oppression and things, and even the investigators. And it's just, it's an epidemic right now, the paranormal community is, and getting into it and the investigations. And we're just trying to think of a way to come against it and to try to help. So he wrote this, and like I said, it was a joint letter in which he had wrote it, and me and Laura contributed, a list of ideas too, and he included them. But nonetheless, it is a joint letter. We agree with the content, So it was an awesome thing to be part of, and I'm very humbled by the fact that I was even, thought of to even help with it. Because, him and Laura both are very knowledgeable, with the subject and everything, and I'm very blessed by them, too. But it was a very good thing. I believe it's even like 14 pages long, but it's so good. Because it brings up a lot of things that a lot of the investigators don't think of, and it also, redirects them to the Bible and what the Bible's got to say about it, and trying to show them where, it is dangerous and all the true facts involved in it. So, I'm very, very happy to be part of it.
Bill, I have a question before we get into our main questions, yeah. unless you have something
yeah,
at
go ahead.
This point. Dana, you use a very good word when you said, in trying to describe the interest in the paranormal, you use the word epidemic. Now, what would you say? And this is something that always crosses my mind. And we've talked a little bit about the exposure of the paranormal on our culture and how it's just saturated our culture. But what would you say to people who still say, you know, you guys who are involved in this, you're nuts, you're crazy, you're conspiracy theorists, you guys are on some sort of hallucinations or something. There's no such thing as the paranormal. What would you say to people who still hold out that everything that we can know for sure is with our five senses?
They just actually are just trying to go by the five senses?
Yeah, they're denying the supernatural. They're saying that the paranormal that you guys are all talking about, it really isn't true. Because I see it a lot of times in the paranormal programs that I watch, that you have either a husband or a wife who is completely oblivious to what's going on, the supernatural activity that's going on in their home until something happens to them. So to the people that nothing really has happened to them, what would you say to those people? Who still resist the notion of the supernatural?
Yeah, I would say to them that the supernatural, the spiritual world is very real. It's very real. We're in a spiritual war. You know, whether anyone knows it or not. I mean, it's just the truth. It's, you know, whether they accept it or not, you know, is a different story. But these things do happen. I mean, it's so real. I mean, it's more real than what I'd even liked it to be. I mean, you know. But the thing about it is, when these things happen, and you rebuke it in the name of Jesus, you know, because people will say, well, how do you know your way's the right way, you know? I've never seen someone cast out a demon with the name of Buddha. I've never, you know what I mean? There's no power. The power is in Jesus. That's how we know that he is the one. He is the Son of God. But the thing about it is, yeah, it's very real. Very real. And actually, these demons, I mean, when someone has an open door to them, they can actually affect them in more ways than having footsteps in the middle of the night. You know what I mean? They oppress the family. There's anger issues. There's depression. There's suicidal thoughts. There's so many different things. Marital problems. I mean, alcohol and drug problems now. And I tell you what, that is one of the dark, deep secrets in the paranormal community. And I know a lot of people are going to rebuke me for that, and I really genuinely am in concern about it, but it is true that a lot of them, and it's not that they're hallucinating these things because they're on drugs or drink, or, you know, have any kind of addictions or whatever, but the things are real. But the thing about it is, it's just you're more open to the demonic, and the demonic does come in different ways, and you're more prone, you're weaker. You know, Jesus is our strength. You know, the Bible tells us that, you know, that he is our strength, and when you don't have Jesus, you're weaker to those type of things. And the devil is out to, you know, steal, kill, and destroy, and he does it in many more ways than one, you know, but they do affect us in many ways, and I mean, that alone is a reason to believe that that demons are real, you know, and stuff. People, it's terrible. It's just terrible, you know, the deception that's out there, releasing your spirits and stuff like that. It's just it's so bad, and these people are grieving for their dead loved ones, and they have a spirit that comes along and masquerades as their dead loved ones, and they come to you and they tell you, you know what, my mom came to me last night, and they're grieving for their mother. It's so hard to look at that person and look them in the eye and say, dear, it's not your mother. It's not your mother. It's a demon. They don't want to hear that. You don't want to tell them that. And I think that that's one of the reasons, sadly, that some of the churches don't speak up and say it and talk about it, because they don't want to hurt their members, or, you know, because they know people within the church that has lost a loved one, and they, oh, you know, we had... we had a light flickering last night, and it was in her own room, or, you know what I mean, and you don't want to take that away from them. And I mean, it happens to me all the time. I've had people tell me that, you know, honest to God, come to me and said stuff like that just recently, and I was like, I'm please just know, you know, the devil masquerades, and he doesn't play fair. He really doesn't. Mm-hmm. He's much more worse than people want to give him credit to be. You know, he doesn't care about us. He doesn't have sympathy. You know, he'll do that. He'll pretend to be your dead child. You know, and how sad is that, you know?
Yeah.
It's wrong. Yeah. It's horrible. You know, especially when someone's lost their child. They don't want to believe that it's not their child. You know, they want to believe that their child's there. They don't want to let them go. You know, that's the thing about death, you know, when we lose our loved ones. We don't want to let them go, you know. It's part of our grieving. It's natural, you know. But the thing about it is, I would rather believe that they're in heaven, you know what I mean, than running around on earth as a bastard. You know, God wouldn't do that to his children. You know, God would not lose us. You know, the Bible says that he knows every hair on our head. We're more important than many sparrows, and he knows every time a sparrow hits the ground. He doesn't lose us. You know, he knows where we're at all times. And we're like I said, we're appointed to die, wants to die. We're appointed. Yeah. He knows when we're going to die. He doesn't lose us. We don't get away from him. We have angels around. You think about the story in Luke 16, you know, with a beggar and the rich man. And it said that the beggar was carried to heaven by an angel. And you know, these angels are always around us. They encamp us. They protect us. They report things to God, too, like it says in Matthew. You know, it talks about our Father in heaven, the angels, their angels behold their Father, our Father in heaven. You know, if someone does something to these children, you know, I'm paraphrasing, but, you know, these angels are around us, and then people say, well, you don't go to hell. You know, you sleep in the grave, or you roam around the earth, because we don't go to hell till after the end. That's not true. You know, the Bible says that we go to hell, and where the rich man was in hell, and he lifted his eyes up in torment.
Yeah.
That's not sleep in the grave, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like Jesus
That's
said,
right.
He says, well, he says, fear him that can cast your body and soul in hell, destroy your soul and body in hell. You know what I mean? It doesn't... Don't just worry about the one that can kill your body, you know? And you know, the people just have this misconception about hell being after Judgment Day, or, you know, that's not what's going to happen. Even hell and the dead that are you know, the unbelievers and the wicked that's in hell, you know, when Judgment Day comes, them and hell is going to be tossed in the lake of fire.
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's no purgatory. You know, there's so many deceptions. You know, God said the way is straight, right? I mean, but there's so many of those roads that go off of it. There's so many lies.
That's right.
You know, that Satan is so enticing. He's always trying to lead people astray, and he does it in so many ways. There's so many lies, you know. But these people don't know, and they're afraid. And to be honest, a lot of people would reject me right now. You know why? Because they would say, why are you talking about the devil? You know, you shouldn't even worry about that. Don't focus on that. No, the devil wouldn't want me to tell people this. You know, the devil wouldn't want us to know the truth. You know, it's only in Jesus that we find the truth. Mm-hmm. Jesus, it's the truth that Jesus has set us free. You know,
that's right.
It's just people think, well, I could still go to a ghost hunt and be a Christian. As long as I'm not doing EVPs and I'm just hanging out with them and I'm going to help so-and-so. Well, tell me this, when you talk to the people, okay, and you're trying to lead that person to Christ and you're telling them the truth of Jesus and you're telling them, they're saying, well, you know, I've been doing this and I've been doing that. I've been in tarot cards, or I've been doing this and that. Okay, are you going to tell that person in front of that group there, the whole group there that's doing these EVPs and all, are you going to tell that person, well, this here is wrong, though. You can't be doing this stuff that they're doing, because, you know, that right there is going to lead you to destruction, you know? And people say, I mean, it's just so, the ideas, you know what I'm saying? It's just, it's the devil, man. He's always trying to fool people with different ideas and his deceptions and stuff. It's like, man, I to be honest with you, when I first got delivered, it was in 2011, and at first I thought, you know, I'm going to reach out, I'm going to start, you know, ministering about this and start trying to, you know, show the deception. Well, for a while there, I kind of dropped out of doing that, and I just started really just getting in the Bible, which I still am. I love it. You know, I have a hunger for it now. Mm-hmm. I really do. I'm always looking up stuff. Do y'all do that?
Oh, yeah.
I mean, it's like you'll hear something. You're like, wait a minute, let me look up that verse. Isn't there a verse that says, well, you know, I'm always doing that. I teach Bible study at our church and everything, and I preach there, too, once in a while. And we're actually doing a series right now on familiar spirits and how they operate and everything. Mm-hmm. But because people do need to know, you know, but it's just we have to know these things, you know. And so anyway, I started going on to that and just thinking, well, maybe I'll preach. Maybe I'll just, you know, and I really honest to God kept thinking, well, if I associate with any of what my past was or talk about it much, then, you know, it's going to bring problems and all this. But you know what? That's not what the devil would want me to believe that. This is my testimony. You know, this is my testimony, and God is going to use it for the good. You know, he's turned it around, and now I'm going to go out and I'm going to tell people, you know, as long as there's breath in my body, I am going to tell people about this deception, and I know people will get upset at me. I know all this stuff. Jesus said, you know, they're going to hate you because they hated me first. Mm-hmm. You know, we can't always go on the fact that it's going to be rejected. It's going to be rejected. You know, the world is at enmity with God, you know, no matter what. You know, you can't combine the two. It's not going to work. They don't blend. Mm-hmm. You know, if you start blending, there's something wrong. Mm-hmm. You know, the Holy Spirit is grieved when we sit and compromise and, you know, things like that. The truth has to be spoken. We have to do it in a loving manner, though. You know, that's another thing that one time I started, you know, really getting upset. I blurted out stuff, you know, but you got to be able to use humility and remember your place. You know, we're a servant of Jesus, you know. Mm-hmm. He's a king. He's the one, you know. We need to glorify him, you know, and take up our cross and follow him. But it's just... So I decided, you know, that that's exactly what I'm going to do, is just start doing what I'm meant to do and let my past, you know, be changed to be used for something for the good, you know. And it's hard. It's really hard when you come across people that, you know, reject this truth, you know, because they get upset.
Oh, yeah.
When I used to do that, you know, like I said, when people would try to show me, hey, you know, Dana, this stuff is demons and all. And I used to accuse them of, you know, oh, you see a demon under every rock. You know, I used to be that guy, you know.
Yeah.
I used to be the one that used to say that. And it's weird because now it's like I know they're going to say that because I know how they felt, you know. I know because I used to feel the same way, you know. But the thing about it is we just have to show it to them in love. And just the way I would want somebody to show it to me if I'm in error, because, like I said, no one's beyond deception, you know. Mm-hmm. And when we start thinking we're beyond it, there's going to be a problem. God will put us in our place. Mm-hmm. You know, they like the story of Job, it does say that he was righteous in his own eyes, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And God rebuked him, and he rebuked him in a whole chapter of rebuking him. You know, where were you at when this and that happened, and where were you when the foundations were laid, and where was he, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
God puts us in our place, so I have to stay there. But
let me ask you this, Dana.
Sure.
There are so many paranormal television programs. None of them are quote-unquote Christian-based paranormal investigators. How widespread do you think Christian paranormal investigators are? What presence do they have in this field?
I'll be honest with you, when I was in it, I thought I was a Christian. So it's kind of like, what do you say? You know, I don't want to judge anybody and say, oh, they're not a Christian if they're doing these things. But God's Word does specifically draw that line between a pagan and a Christian. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And if you're walking in darkness, and I mean walking in it, not just somebody that so happens to sin and they ask for forgiveness. I'm talking about somebody that just walks in it and they don't feel condemned for it. I truly believe that I was saved after when I got delivered. Even though I was younger as a child and I prayed and I thought I was saved, but I think that with the television, you see these exorcists that come out. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I don't know really how to answer that. I really have been battling with that one because, you know, I do believe, like I said, when I was in there, I even had family members that was in it too, that was also in church, and you know, and even other members that I knew that was in church, and they believed in using the name of Jesus and all, but they also didn't see anything wrong with these occultic ways, you know?
Yeah.
They didn't understand that, and I believe that these, the paganisms of the Bible that you read about in Deuteronomy and stuff, where it says, don't consult with familiar spirits, don't, no necromancers and all this, this is the same thing that was going on then. The technology wasn't the same, but this is the same thing that was going on then, and they were called pagans. You know, I mean, I hate to say that, you know, because I mean, I'm not trying to judge any one person, but I'm just saying that's what the Bible says. You know, I have to go by that.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me ask, based on that, Dana, based on Deuteronomy chapter 18 and also Leviticus chapter 20, which you and Mark and Laura mentioned in your open letter to Christian paranormal investigators, how much resistance do you get from those professing Christianity when this is, these scriptures are crystal clear against,
you know what,
trying to contact the dead?
Truthfully, they believed that we are no longer under Old Testament. And I believe it cannot be no further from the truth. You know, Jesus, when he said that he what did you say? He said that he does not remove one jot or one tittle from the law. And he said, I've come to fulfill the law, not destroy it. When he said fulfill, he's talking about the sacrificial, you know, he came here so we can be saved and accept him as our Lord and Savior and everything. But the law still applies. I mean, unless it was specifically excluded and said so, you know, like he said, don't let no one judge you by meat or by what do you call it, Sabbath and the Sabbath day and all this stuff, you know what I mean? But this stuff, it was so forbidden, and the implications were so severe. Look at who was it, Samuel and Saul, when it said that he actually was killed. I mean, God killed him over it, what he did. You know, so it took his life, you know, and his son, wasn't it, or something like that. But anyway, I believe that we are totally still under that, you know. We're still supposed to, if we love him, we'll obey him. But it's just, I believe that we're still under that. And Jesus said, like, on the Sermon on the Mount, when that was New Testament, he said something about if your right hand causes you to sin, cut it off. You know, and it's better to go around with one hand than it is to go to hell with both. You know, so he's saying right there, you know, if this stuff causes you to, hey, you know, do what you got to do to forsake that stuff, because it can lead you to hell. So that tells me that it still applies, you know.
Sure.
But you know what it is? They don't, the reason why it's so hard to believe, when you're into it, you're still blinded. You know, I really believe that. I believe that it's hard to persuade someone unless they're at the point of desperation and they're wanting, you know, they would have had to have come to a place where they're ready in their spirit and in mind to accept it. You know, and I think that's it's true. And people think, well, if I believe that Jesus in my heart and I believe who he said he was, then I'm saved, you know what I mean? But do you believe on Jesus, you know, like the Bible says? And that would mean, to me, believe on him and trust in him. You know, we have to go by his ways and trust his ways and obey him, you know? So I hope that answers the question somewhat.
Dana, in the open letter that was drafted by yourself and Mark and Laura, there's a quote here that says this: there is an unprecedented disaster unfolding before our very eyes, and sadly, it involves Christians in the paranormal community. Why don't churches that these Christians belong to warn them of the dangers involved? I mean, shouldn't it be very clear to the leaders of those, the elders of those churches?
I believe it's happening for a few reasons. Number one, I believe that this is happening for the same reasons you see other sins being committed at an accelerating rate. I feel that, sadly, it's because most churches have become lukewarm. as they have become much more hesitant before preaching on certain sins for fear of losing members. It could be, this could be simply because of money, too. You know, money, the love of money is the root of all evil. And look at how much that prosperity gospel is out, you know? It's so money-driven. It's like all evil is really at an accelerated rate. We're in the last days. I feel like we are. And it's a, and also not wanting to hurt the members, like I was talking about, where, you know several of them that probably do believe in earthbound spirits. Heck, even maybe the preacher does. We, you know what I mean? But they just they just don't understand it. You know, it's, it, I mean, anybody is not above being deceived. So even people in the church, you know, can be deceived. And that would even include the pastors and not wanting to accept the truth, you know. But I believe it has a lot to do with it. I really do.
Yeah, this is this is something that Joe and I have addressed in the past. And actually, we talked about this as well with Mark when we had him on our show. About how, you know, people today that are dealing with these things, and, all right, let's say even the Christian paranormal investigators themselves, the churches today don't address this enough to where the supernatural is talked about, where spiritual warfare is talked about. You know, you watch a lot of these TV shows, and things that people experience, they go to the churches, and I'm not even talking about Roman Catholic churches, but they'll go to the local church and ask for help, and the pastors and elders there don't even know how to help them. So if they don't know how to help someone who is going through you know, supernatural activity in their home, how are they going to warn a Christian paranormal investigator of the dangers that they are getting themselves into? So I think that you bring up a good point here in that, you know, there's really nothing for them in a church setting to point them in a direction that they need to go.
We're losing the battle at the front lines. The reason I say that is because it's like not only they don't really want to preach on the sin too much, but also you are so right, dead on. Wow, I can't tell you how many when we were getting all those attacks. I heard on Blog Talk Radio, it was actually Omega Man and Rich Keltner and them, and I was hearing about deliverances and stuff on there, because I was looking it up, like, what do I do, you know? And you look it up, first guy that's going to come up is him, you know, Omega Man. Well, anyway, so I started going and looking at this, and I'm like, gosh, no deliverance, wow, you know, they really cast these demons out and stuff. I mean, you know, I just didn't know. I'd never seen it. I all my years in church, I never seen a demon cast out of nobody. That's crazy. It's horrible, because that's the front line. That's why we're losing. You know, that's the battle right there. And if we're not even fighting the battle, we're gonna be, they're gonna win. You know, it's like a bunch of soldiers coming at you, you know what I mean? And you're the only one standing there, and you don't want no one to fight with you. You know what I'm saying? That's why they're having a victory. That's why there's, that's why evil is reigning so much. They don't think that deliverance is for today. And that's so not true, you know. It's tragic, actually.
It is.
You know, it's like wow, because you're right. I mean, I didn't know any church around here. I was asking questions at some of the local churches. I'm like, you know, do y'all do the, you know, what do you do? And, you know, and I don't know. You know, just pray about it. You know what I mean? And I never really heard that you have to. You really just should submit to God, and that means giving up everything else. If there's a point in your life that you're not willing to submit, you're still in darkness in that area. You're not giving it up yet, so you're still going to be affected by that. You're still going to suffer oppression in that area. Mm-hmm. You know, one time, and I'm not going to elaborate who it is, but I watched someone one time. They were getting delivered, and it had to do with spirits that they were being tormented by. Well, the pastor asked. He says, well, I don't know. I think that it was the Holy Spirit trying to give him some cue there, you know. But he had asked the person, is there any drug addiction problems or anything? And the person said no. Mm. Well, the person wasn't willing to give that up yet.
Yeah.
But all the demonic stuff as far as the paranormal stuff stopped. That was years ago. But they still to this day struggle with the drugs. Mm-hmm. You see what I mean? It's like sure. It's like you can't, you have to submit that under, you have to give that to God. You have to say, okay, no more. I'm giving that to you, you know, please, you know, give me the power over it and you know, take that desire from me. That was another thing that pastor did when he prayed for me. He was praying and he asked God, he said, Father God, he said, I ask that you take this desire out of her for this attraction she has to the paranormal and the occult and to take it from her, you know, and all this, and it happened, you know. I didn't want it no more. And mm-hmm. and it was like, now when I go in the store, I see, you know, just stuff that has to do represent death and everything. It hurts me. Mm-hmm. You know, I feel like, gosh, you don't even know. You know, I mean, mm-hmm. I just weep over it. I mean, really, I just feel like, oh, man, these people, you know, it's just, your eyes are open. You know, when God, when you submit to God and everything, he'll, I think that's part of discernment, don't you? Yes. It's part of the Holy Spirit. When you really submit yourself and you get Holy Spirit filled, part of that sure. is discernment. And I think that God, that's part of that when your eyes are open, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But I think that it's the lack of fighting the battle is why we're not winning. And I think that somehow, I mean, I just wish the churches knew. You know, the church members are suffering, you know? You can look out in a congregation, this person, this, and that, and you look in their eyes, and, I mean, you just want to weep, you know, mm-hmm. like, gosh, if they only knew, you know? Mm-hmm. It's so sad. It really is. Think about that.
Let me ask this question, and Bill, chime in as well, if you, please, if you want to. Do you think the issue of Christians getting involved in the paranormal investigations themselves and generally Christians with a blind eye to the paranormal as to what is really going on there, is it more prevalent within certain denominations, or do you think that it has infested all of Christendom?
I believe it has affected all of Christendom, and I believe that it really kind of, I don't want to say it started with the Catholic Church, but I think they're more prone to it because they're taught that necromancy is okay, you know, mm-hmm. and prayer to the saints and all this stuff.
Yeah.
So they're more, there's more like a level of deception, I guess, there. But even in the evangelical churches and Pentecost, all them, you know, they still go by the Bible, you know, but the thing about it is, like I said, the lack of preaching and of it and all that nowadays is even, that's even happening in those churches. So it's like, I believe that it's really all, you know, I believe more so now with the true Christian church is what I want to say, the biblical church.
Yeah.
I think that's more so now than what it was before. But before, I think it was more common probably with the Catholicism and Catholic church. Because they go and investigate and stuff before they do exorcisms and stuff, you know. So that was always kind of part of their ritualistic ways of doing their exorcisms. Is they go in there, they mm-hmm. have to try to first determine that there's something going on and all that nonsense. But, you know, so I think now, though, it's got so bad, our churches have, so, you know, the biblical churches where, you know, they don't know how long it is. You know, they don't hear much on it.
Mm-hmm.
I that's what I think.
Well, here's a question that I think that it really bears delving into, and it's based on a statement that is found in the open letter that you and Mark and Laura drafted. You three say that so many investigators are themselves plagued with demonic activity and are suffering in a multitude of ways, and that this is the deep, dark secret of the paranormal community. Now, Dana, what can you share with our listeners with regards to this? Because I think it's very important, especially when we talked about the numbers of paranormal groups that are still forming, and they're still watching these television, these paranormal shows, and they're still looking for the thrill. What can you say about the dangers that are involved with regards to this?
I when I was in the paranormal, I never met an investigator that was not having some kind of paranormal activity going on in their home.
Let me stop you before you even go on any further.
Sure.
That's not revealed. It's barely, barely touched upon in any of the paranormal shows that you see on TV. That's why you say it's the deep, dark secret.
Yes, 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 it is. And I, there was actually so much stuff within just the people I knew that I associated with that had so many things going on in their lives. There was always drugs. And I'm not saying all of them are. Please forgive me. I don't mean that. But I just know from what I've experienced and what I've seen, because it wouldn't be fair for me to say, you know what I mean, for other people,
yeah.
I guess. But honestly, the people that I knew, there was a lot of them that, you know, were on drugs or alcohol, or even though our rule was you couldn't be on drugs and alcohol to go to a ghost hunt, or you know what I mean, or anything like that, but they were using, you know, bad addictions. And then there's so many people that I knew so many people that was like, they would leave their husband or their wife, or they was cheating, or it was always marital issues. There was always like anger issues, depression. Oh my goodness. You know, there was a lot of people that had so many different issues. And I know they could come back and say, well, that's anybody. But, you know, you see how these things can affect you. And once you get delivered of it and everything, it's funny that a lot of that stops. You know, I mean, we are going to have problems, you know, here and there in our life. But it's like in the paranormal community, it was like they were plagued with it. You know, we were.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't want to, like I said, just say them, but me too. I was too. But there were so many issues like that, you know, and it's sad because I've seen families ripped apart, people I knew. There was another person, and I just don't want to say a name, but it's so heartbreaking. But one of the investigators that we had that did a lot of the provoking, he just died. And I've lost contact with him for a while because he unfriended me on Facebook. You know, actually a lot of them did. You know, when I came out and said, look, guys, you know, I mean, they turn on you, you know. God has a way of separating you. You know. But so a lot of them did. Well, I lost contact with him, but every now and again I would see somebody out and talk, oh, how's he doing, you know, and all this. Well, his girlfriend that he, you know, lived with, he had left his wife a couple times, and you know, and all this stuff. And so well, then I found out because I was looking on Facebook after he had died, and I was like, gosh, I just wondered, you know what I mean? Because he was totally not a believer that I knew of, you know, and his girlfriend was a Wiccan. Yeah, she believed in the Wiccan ways and everything. And so anyway, when I was looking on there and I looked back, well, he had a heart attack like a month before he actually died. But he had a heart attack, and he had to be airlifted, and they had to put a stent in and everything. Well, and then I kept going back in the the feed and come to find out, like, it was like within a month that he actually had put up an altar in his house for the girlfriend, you know, that was a Wiccan and everything. It was a Wiccan altar, whatever that looks like. But he had put it up, and within a month he had heart attack, and he had to have surgery and everything. Well, then after he got out, I think it was like a month later, he dropped her off of work, went to work and everything, and come to find out he died at work. He literally just died at work, and he was only 42, I believe. That was it, you know. And I just, you hear this stuff, and everybody's like, oh, you know, I feel so bad. I mean, out for her and all, you know, all this stuff. And I'm like, it really upset me, because I was like, I talked to him, and I mean, even in the video where that guy had got thrown and everything, he's on there and he's talking, and I said something about, you know, well, maybe the reason we're protected is because we've been praying about it. Because remember, I told you when we got the investigation, me and the girl and my daughter was walking around praying. Well, he wasn't. He was saying, don't do that. He's the one that's saying that, and everything. And he anyway, so when I said that, I said something about, well, we've been praying about it. Maybe that's why we haven't been attacked. And he said, oh, I don't think it has anything to do with prayers. I don't even think it has anything to do with religion. You know, he said, I think it's all science, you know, if you ask me. And I was like, God, I'm like, I'd be scared if I was you. I mean, that's what I was saying, you know, on the tape and everything. You know, because every now and again, I'll kind of look at that. I'm like, oh, God, yeah, I can't believe I'm doing that. But yeah, I just, my heart goes out. And he was always, I mean, he was such a nice guy, though. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I mean, we were so close when we were in it and everything. I mean, there was many hours that we sat in these houses and talked, and we talked about the afterlife and, you know, and everything. But, you know, like I said, he got upset when, you know, when I left it and everything. He just kind of cut ways with me. And I, to this day, I feel so bad. And that's another reason I was like, I'm so dedicated to try to bring awareness about it, you know, because I just know these things can destroy people, and they can destroy their lives, you know. I mean, many things can, but, you know, sin is the wages of death, right?
Yes.
I mean, even in the paranormal and the occult, it's sin, you know? So I mean, we're all going to die. I'm not saying that, you know, we're going to be some can be perfect, die. But, you know, God also promises so many years if you do what you know what I'm saying? Do what you're supposed to do and all this. But I just feel like he was taken short, if you know what I mean. And and I also had seen another video where he was actually at a investigation, and he was on there provoking and doing his vows and lodge, you know, and he was on there saying stuff like, you know, well, get out of here. And he's like, oh, one, you're an innocent. I'm like, oh, you know, now I see that. I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, he was, you know, challenging demons. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's so devastating, you know. I truly just mourn him, because I feel so bad. I just hope to God that he prayed, or that he came to believe before it happened, you know.
Yeah, amen to that. Dana, let me ask you this. You mentioned earlier about the use of digital voice recorders and electronic instrumentation, such as the ghost box and the ovulus, and those are some of the things that we see on the paranormal programs on television, if you watch them. Now, why do you categorize the use of these mechanical instruments as false science? I mean, after all, they are receiving messages. They are receiving some sort of information, allegedly, from the spirit world. Why do you categorize it as false science?
The reason I say that is because, okay, to use scientific means to determine the origin of something spiritual or supernatural is an oxymoron. You know, the supernatural, the paranormal, is outside the realm of the physical natural. The only thing that these instruments can do is provide evidence that there is something there, but it cannot prove what its origin is. The supernatural cannot be explained by natural means. That's why it's called supernatural or paranormal.
Right.
You know, these instruments, like I said, and even unbelievers out there that's in the paranormal community, a lot of them know that sometimes a demonic spirit can impersonate a dead person. But what gets me, why is it so inconceivable to them that this is perhaps always the case? Because it is. You see, because our spirit goes on. We're not here when we die. So, you know, these are familiar spirits. We see it in the Bible, and it happens so much. you know, that we see what happens. But how do they know? How can they say beyond a shadow of a doubt that no, you know, that they're not all familiar spirits, that they're actually, you know, Uncle Joe or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I just wish I knew how they could say that, you know. And I was, like I said, I was one of them. I thought the same thing, you know.
Yeah.
Same thing with, like, the residual hauntings. I believed in that, too, you know, which is ludicrous. I hate to say it so blunt, but it is. It's ridiculous, you know. It's not even scientifically or biblically correct, you know. Totally a theory, and it's really not even a theory because you can't really test it or reproduce it in a laboratory. So it's just the whole idea that they can test it by EMF and you know, EVPs and stuff. They're only going by what the five senses are telling them through these things. Like, what did it say? What's it forming as in front of them that they can see? You know, all this stuff. How in the world are you going to say what kind of spirit it is except by what they tell you? Mm-hmm. And if you're only going by hey, I mean, they could be lying. They do lie.
They do.
Satan is the master of all, a father of all lies, I should say, and so is his demons. His demons lie, too, you know, but they don't believe that. They think, oh, well, you know, we got to ask the spirit what's it, you know, who is it or whatever, or why it's here.
Yeah.
I don't believe in all that. I just don't. I don't see it needed. But yeah, they it's just, how do they come to that is beyond me. I don't, now looking back at it, I'm like, wow, I can't believe I even thought that. I mean, how did I even come to that conclusion?
When these paranormal investigators go to clients and the investigation is performed and information comes through when they're trying to reach these deceased humans of the clients, and they receive information that, you know, the investigators could not have known. So how is it that demons deceive investigators into believing that these humans, deceased humans, are causing the problems that the paranormal investigators are called in to investigate? How do they pull that off?
They do it by way of, it's the tactic of the enemy. It's coming, the familiar spirit thing. And what he does is he tries to appear as something else. And like, say, for instance, if somebody goes into investigation and they know that someone died in the home, just say it was a child named Bob, you know, or something. Well, you'll get voices that say something about Bob. It'll answer questions. And, you know, demons know what happened there. You know, they've been around us ever since we've been born.
Mm-hmm.
They know everything about us. They know where I put something in the closet. They know what I told so-and-so on the phone. And they know these things. And people think that since there's a validation, that there's something there that knows, that is intelligent, they automatically believe and swallow the rest of the lie. They don't consider, wait a minute, maybe this dude's lying, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But the thing about it is, if they were to challenge it and say, in the name of Jesus, go, you know, and I mean, of course, they'd have to have authority over it. You know, it would flee. I mean, I'm sorry, but, you know, even when I hadn't come to my knowing the truth and everything and got my deliverance before that, when we said, leave in the name of Jesus, it did. But it always returned.
Mm.
You know, they do cower at the name of Jesus, but they come back.
Right.
You know, but the whole thing about it is, until you close that door and stop whatever it is that's contributing to that open door, once that happens, then it really does stop, you know. And they would know that if they really would just try that, you know. I really wish that more people would challenge these spirits and do that, you know. And honestly, like when someone gets saved, okay, and they come to the, you know, and they want to get saved and everything, get delivered, okay, and angels rejoice, but the devil gets angry. You know, he'll try, you know, a lot of these people, when they start coming to that knowledge and they try to, you know, question, and I'll be honest, you know what, after that happened with that boy, when he was thrown and everything, and that's when I started really questioning, are any spirits really demons, you know? And on my blog talk shows, I actually had a couple of them called religion versus the paranormal. And honest to God, every time I had those shows, and I would bring this up about, you know, how we always would hear, oh, so-and-so said in the name of Jesus, leaving it left. Whenever we would bring this up, people would automatically come against me, and they would get defensive, get upset at me even, you know, and would say, oh, you know, everybody believes, you know, and really get upset and stuff. But with that, it's just the enemy doing that, you know, in them that's causing that defensive mechanism, you know. But they would always not want to hear that. And what I'm saying is, like, why is it so inconceivable? They'll believe all these other stupid beliefs. You know, think about it. You know, like this residual haunting and stuff, you know. It's like when we used to plug in the EMF pump and that electricity would go in there and, you know, you would see it going back. You unplugged it, it would stop and dissipate and go. You know what I'm saying? It doesn't keep going. It doesn't have a mind of its own. It's not intelligent by any means.
Yeah.
You know, so how in the world, if they can swallow that kind of lie, why is it so inconceivable? Because what we believe, there is evidence, you know, when we would rebuke it and it does leave, you know, and stuff. Why? You know, all they know is that something's happening, but they yet cannot figure out what it is. There's no way they can. But all these instruments, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter because all it does is prove that something's there. Yeah. But, you know, and they it's just some of these beliefs, they always say, well, that I can swallow, but that other I can't. You know, it's like, why? You know, think about that. You know, why?
Joe, can I follow up here, Joe?
Yeah, Bill, go ahead.
Yeah. I think that you guys are talking about something that is that needs to be emphasized here. And, you know, as I'm looking back at, you know, at the open letter that that you prepared, Dana, along with Mark and Laura, and point number 3 says here in your highlighted points, it says, the clients don't need validation of something that they already know is true. They need deliverance and conversion. So, and you go on to say, if you are truly called by God, then you may consider deliverance as your vocation. And this is exactly the main point here. Okay, if you're a Christian and you say that you are also a paranormal investigator and you're bringing all these gadgets with you, What these people don't need you to tell them that something's going on. They already know that. What they need to hear from a Christian paranormal investigator is that you need Jesus Christ. You need to be saved. And so, you know, turn in your paranormal investigator badge and take up the badge of Christ as someone who can deliver them from the darkness into the light. You know,
praise God, you got it right.
I think that's the whole thing right there. Is like these people who say that they're a Christian, but yet they want to still the thrill of doing paranormal investigating. They're losing the whole point of what they're doing.
Yes, amen. Yes, I had a gentleman tell me the other day we were discussing that exact issue, and he says, how in the world do you think you can get any knowledge if you don't investigate and find out what they're saying? You can't get knowledge unless you ask them. And I'm thinking, excuse me, you're going to tell me you're going to get some kind of knowledge out of demons?
Uh-huh.
Instead of getting your knowledge out of the Holy Spirit, which teaches all things?
Amen.
You know, go by God's word. That's all the knowledge we need. It's sufficient. You know, we don't need to know anything these demons have to say. They lie. They're deceptive. There's a motive behind their madness. You know, they're trying to lead you to hell, you know. But I totally agree with you.
Yeah, and you know, Bill and Dana, here's the flip side to that. As many paranormal shows as I have watched, and indeed this is one of the things that the Lord used to draw me into this ministry along with Bill, inevitably, what you will see at the end of these paranormal shows, they present the first 80% of it is the darkness of the infestation, and then at the end, the picture becomes brighter, and you hear the tinkling piano. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And all the people wanted to have happen is for the problems that they were experiencing, the oppression that they didn't know what it was. They just wanted it to go away. It's like you have a problem with mice. You call the exterminator in. You just want the mice to be gone. You want the ants to be gone. When people call the paranormal investigators in, all they want to do is they want to get back to their normal lives. And that is the issue I've always had, is that you don't need... That is one of the greatest deceptions of the devil. Now, think about that. Mm-hmm. When you have these investigators come in, they know, the devil knows that what the people want is for the infestation to end. So what they do is they make it look like these investigators have the power to make it end.
That's right.
It's a tremendous deception.
Yes.
Exactly. But as you said so eloquently, Bill, a minute ago, is that what they need, they don't need the infestation to end per se. What they need is to pass from death to life. It's like the parable that Jesus told of the demon that was cast out from the man, and the demon went and sought another place and found only arid land and came back to the original person that it possessed. No conversion had taken place, no rebirth had taken place, and he brought seven more spirits more evil than him, and the end result was that guy was worse than when the first demon was cast out of him. So this is the whole issue, I think, in wrapping this whole discussion up. This is, for people who are listening, that is what, if you're involved in Christian paranormal investigations, you know what, I'll let Dana wrap it up for you, but from my perspective, and I'm sure from Bill's perspective, we've been harping on this for years, Bill, you don't need the people to be at peace in their homes. Amen. What you need is for people to be at peace with God. What you need is to have that enmity that you have with God ended. And the fact that demons, if paranormal investigators come in and they, quote-unquote, they get rid of the problem, your problem still remains with God.
Amen.
Yes. Amen. Amen. That's right. They don't need somebody to go in their home taking pictures and soliciting EVPs to validate their claims. First of all, we cannot go by what these demons tell us. As we know, they lie. They cannot go, and we cannot go by what they look like, because we know that even Satan himself can masquerade as an angel of light. So these demonic spirits can manifest to look like anything. For instance, if they appear to look like someone's deceased grandmother, does that prove it's her? No. When the paranormal investigators in the field that are not believers even know that these spirits can mimic, you know, someone that they're not. So my question is, like I said, why is it so inconceivable that perhaps this is always the case? It would be no different, okay, if someone were to come to me in desperation, telling me that they have a serious drug addiction, would I give them a drug test? Or would I minister to them and lead them to Christ and help them get delivered?
Amen.
What they need is the gospel of Christ, because it is the truth of Christ that sets us free.
Hallelujah.
It's that. That's the only thing that can break the back of the enemy. You know, it can break the yoke. I mean, Jesus is the way. You know, it's not the investigators. They come in here, come in places like that, like some kind of a ghost guru. I mean, excuse my the way I express that, but come on, you know, it's like, oh, I've been in investigation so many years, and I know this and I know that. No, it just tells me that you're even more deceived because you've been in it so long. You know, that the more you're in it, the more deceived you become. You know, so that's nothing really to brag about, you know. I seen this one the other day. My dad called me up, and he said, Danny, you're not going to believe this. Now, he doesn't like watching them, but he kind of come across this, and he they were talking. It was a ghost hunter. He was talking. He was with Zach Bagans, and he had mentioned something about they called him in there to talk to this girl to let her know that she needed to be careful and quit going into this place that she was so obsessed with going to because she really wanted to do ghost hunts. And he comes in, and he says, you got to be careful. You don't even know what you're dealing with. And sometimes, you know, these things are demons, and, you know, they do that sometimes. You have to know the difference. And I'm thinking to myself, how do you know the difference? You're just as deceived as this poor girl is. You know, it's just,
Yeah.
They think they come in here like I said, some kind of ghost guru. It's just ridiculous. You know, it's, oh my goodness. It's like, yeah, there's a reason that these beings can't get over to the light, right? They're demons.
That's right.
There's no way that they can go to the light. They can't get saved. It's almost like a mockery of people trying to lead someone with the gospel to the light, the light of Jesus. You know, it's like the Satan, that's their lie. Well, I need a ghost hunter to lead me to the light with the demon. It's ridiculous. It's just a mockery of Christianity is all it is. These demons are in the, and what's so crazy is that when people are into it like this, they're truly embracing their enemy. They don't even know it. You know, that's what's so sad, you know? And I believe that when my mom was praying, my mom and my brother Donnie was praying for me to see these things for what they were, I believe that that's when all these things started getting so bad. So if somebody has someone that they know that is in the paranormal and they want them to get out of it, my suggestion is pray. Pray for them, because where we can't do it and we're not able, God can. He knows how to get someone. You know what I mean? He'll do what he can. He'll do what he can do. Okay, it's in the, it's their choice, though. You know, we have a free will. But my suggestion is to pray for them, you know. Yes, witness to them. They might more than likely reject it. But the thing about it is, boy, if you pray about it, you know, people always think that's the last resort. That's the first resort. That's what we always should do is pray, man. Because I mean, that's what everything's in God's hands. You know what I mean? When we pray about it and stuff, I mean, we leave it. We leave his hand, you know, sometimes. But he's actually in control. And he can let things happen, just like he did in the book of Job, you know. Mm-hmm. And that's my thing is just, you know, pray about it. I mean, there's so much power in prayer. We're commanded to pray. You know, think about that. Right. We really are.
Yeah.
And I like to pray for our kids and pray for our families and stuff every night, man. My grandson comes in here and we sit down and every night I'm like, if you say your prayers, well, maybe can you stand with me? And I'll sit there and I'll go through it with him, you know. Ask for forgiveness and let the Lord know we love him and thank him for everything he does for us and thank him for protecting us. And I mean, just go down the line. You got to teach them while they're young, you know. That's another thing. The Bibles are gone. You know, I mean, not gone, but they're... People think, oh, it's just because they left out of the schools and stuff. But no, it starts in home, at the home. You know, there's a lot of people that don't want the Bible. You know, they just, and they marry, I mean, the Bible, everything in it is true. And they marry people, you know, and they're unequally yoked, you know. And a lot of times that causes people to go away from the faith. Just like it talks about in Deuteronomy, I think I can't remember what it's happening, Deuteronomy 15:15 or something like that, but it talks about, I don't marry their sons or their daughters, you know what I mean, because they'll cause you to leave, you know, the Lord and everything, and, but it's just, people are not listening or reading their Bibles. That's our manual to go by, you know,
that's our
moral compass right there, is all in God's Word, and, I mean, I always suggest books, okay, to people, you know, just like I said with Mark's book and everything, Hunman. Oh, my God, it's the best book in the world. But you always have to, you know, lead them to God's Word.
Amen.
You have to. Sure. That's where the power is. The Word is powerful, and that's so true, you know. People are afraid that they're going to lose somebody if they, you know, preach God's Word to them, but it's actually that Word that divides the you know, the bone from marrow. You know what I'm saying? It's God's Word that has the power. You know,
we're not
going to scare them away with it. They might not want to hear it, but you know what? It planted a seed, and God's going to keep working on it. You know, He'll send another one to water it, and you know, and everything.
Yeah.
But we have to at least plant the seed, and we have to know that it's going to be rejected by many, and we can't please everybody.
Mm-hmm.
We can't
not
and please God too. And who should we please? You know, I wouldn't please God. You know, God is no respecter of man. You know what I mean? No
That's
man.
Right.
It's just,
yes.
It's all about Him, man. He's the one.
Amen.
So, I'm sorry I ramble. Keep on going. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Well, Dana and Joe, hard to believe that we've gone through 2 hours already.
I didn't even know that.
Yeah. I mean, we're having so much fun here that...
I just don't say it was awesome, though. Wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But
it always flies by, Bill, doesn't it?
Yes, it sure does.
Yeah.
Man.
Yeah.
And we've so much enjoyed this tonight, Dana. We've been blessed beyond measure to have you on. And we really do appreciate it. And, you know, we want to have you back. You know, Joe and I have talked about possibly getting a nice little roundtable discussion going here on this subject with yourself, yeah, and with Mark and Laura, and all of us getting together and
oh, that would be so awesome.
And delving into
I love him too so much.
Yeah.
You know.
And delving into
the
two
of my best buds.
So
go ahead, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I mean, this is a subject that, you know, as Joe said at the outset of the broadcast, you know, it's something that is, you know, it's our calling. It's what God had called us to back in 2010. And, you know, yeah, we've gotten off tangents in different directions at times, but we always try and come back to this because, you know, this is where the Lord called us to. He put his finger on something that we needed to address, and you know, and we thank the Lord for yourself and Laura, Mark, others who do this. You know, you brought up Rich Keltner. You know, so many that the Lord has called and is using to combat these lies in our culture today. So,
amen.
You know, we do want to thank.
I want you two to know that I really enjoyed it too, and I really appreciate you guys. You guys really mean a lot to me. I've listened to your shows for a long time, and I do follow you on Facebook. And actually, I just want to mention that I thank God for this miracle that you had this year. And I mean, I really truly celebrated it with my whole heart when you conquered that.
Yeah.
You know, but I just think that was awesome. You know,
thank
I really
you.
Thank God for it.
Yeah, we do.
Amen.
We do as well.
Amen.
It's all him. That's for sure.
Yeah.
So Dana, yeah, how can people find out more about you? You want to give out your contact information?
Yeah, sure. On Facebook, it's actually under Exposing the Enemy, starting with the E. But then my website is ExposingTheEnemy.com, but it starts with the X. It would just take the E off the front of it.
Mm-hmm.
So anybody that wants to, like, look at any kind of articles I have, or I just started doing that, you know. I don't know why, I just felt led to do it, and I'm enjoying it. I really am. And I just feel like God is really helping me with it, too. And and Laura, by the way, I want to go back and mention that she is the host of The Supernatural.
There you go.
At Eternal Radio. And her website is OurSpiritualQuest.com. So, and Mark Hunman, he's awesome. He rocks. he has so much knowledge on the subject. I mean, you guys know that.
Oh, yeah.
On your show and stuff. I've listened to it, and it's like, I mean, I could just sit and listen to those shows over and over because it seems like I always learn something from it. You know, we're always learning, you know.
Amen.
Yeah.
I mean, amen. We're always going to learn, you know. Anything
that's
right. God's word and everything, it's just, it seems like I'm always picking up gold nuggets with it, you know. So,
absolutely.
I love you guys, and I really, like I said, I appreciate everything you do for the kingdom and everything. We need more people to do that, too,
yeah,
you know.
Absolutely.
I wish there was more. Maybe
yeah,
we'll recruit some.
Yeah, there you go.
You know?
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you what, Dana, that's why one of the reasons we did tonight's show. You never know. We can't see we plant the seeds. The work that God does, it's not always for us to see on this side of glory. So we just know that the Lord's going to work in with this program. As well as your ministry, Bill's ministry, me and Bill's ministry, Laura's ministry, Mark's ministry. He's doing amazing things, and he has been, because this is really a crucial issue that really hasn't been addressed by the prevailing church in this age, and it's kind of a niche ministry, but I think that. I think that a lot of people, a lot of believers are coming around to where you came around, Dana, And we're just going to trust the Lord to continue to work in this area.
Yes. Amen. Amen. Yes.
Well, thanks
we
again.
Hope that, we hope that maybe these shows will help, you know. Sorry,
yes,
go ahead.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thanks again, Dana. We look forward to the time when we can get back together with you again. And keep in touch.
Thank you.
Okay?
Yes. Yes. Thank you so much, Bill and Joe.
Okay, really, Dana. Awesome.
I had a good time. And it's always nice to talk to people that's like-minded, isn't it?
It is.
Talk about God.
Amen.
And His Word. And, Lord, it's just awesome, you know.
Amen.
I love it. So.
Okay, Dana. We'll be in touch.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, guys.
God bless.
God bless.
You too.
All right. God bless.
Good night.
Bye-bye. Good night.
Joe?
We still live, Bill? Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, we're still live. We're into the into hour number three, so, you know, we're...
When don't we go into hour number three, Bill?
Yeah. Actually, Joe, hey, it's been so long, so I don't mind hour number three.
No.
You know?
No, absolutely, yeah, yeah. Yeah, very, very informative show tonight, and... as we touched on at the outset, it was very, very interesting and beneficial to hear her perspective as a paranormal investigator, as we know from pop culture, and her coming out of that and understanding how that is a clear, those methods that are employed by paranormal investigators are a clear a transgression of God's word clearly from the scriptures.
Yes.
So it's good to hear how she came out of that, and you know, as we mentioned a little while ago, that for Christians that are involved in that type of those sorts of investigations, that you need to really take a look at what you're doing and is what you're doing, you have to ask yourself, is what you're doing, as we've said clearly tonight, a transgression of God's scripture, clearly against communication with spirits, and we're so thankful that she was able to come on with us tonight, and I'm really looking forward to a round table with Dana and Mark and Laura. Because you know, in 2 hours, Bill, you can only address so many issues, and there's a lot more to address because there is a lot more that's occurring in the paranormal world that we need to really get out there and talk about and get Laura's perspective and Mark's perspective of what's going. We haven't had Mark on, I guess, in It's been at least a year.
Yeah.
Right?
I would think so, yeah.
Yeah, so those friends of ours probably have a better grasp on what's going on contemporarily in the paranormal realm than we do, so it would be great to facilitate that and bring that to the people that are familiar with our program, so... that's something definitely for our listeners to stay tuned for information as to when we actually produce that program.
Yeah, amen. Well, Joe, I want to thank you for tonight. Thanks for leading the show. I thought your line of questioning tonight was just awesome. And... you know, I look forward to the time when we can get back together again. It's, as I said at the outset, it's been so long for us to, you know, in between broadcasts that, you know, you do a show like tonight and all of a sudden you get the hunger back to, you know, want to produce more programs and get back on the air. And you know, I think that we both have that hunger right now, so...
Yeah, because it's crucial because you can never let down your guard in regards to the paranormal. It's it's really, to me, it's one of the greatest deceptions of our time. And more, you know, Dana touched on it tonight, that she believes that the escalation of the paranormal as far as groups actually getting into investigations continues to rise.
Yeah.
So this is not something that's dwindling. It's not going away. If anything, it's getting worse. So, you know, we need to stay on top of this, and this is no time to recede. So, yeah, I mean, the Lord allowing, we want to produce as many programs as we possibly can, not to just to pile up the numbers of programs, but because it's needed. And
yeah,
some biblical clarity needs to be continually brought to this issue, because the voices for the opposition, for the enemy, are so numerous,
mm-hmm.
and they have the right. They have the microphone, Bill.
Yeah, they
you
sure
know
do.
they have the television.
Yep.
You know, and that's the number one outlet.
It is,
in my mind. That's the number one outlet, because from there people get led to other things. They go to the internet,
mm-hmm.
you know, and they start looking up things that they hear on all the paranormal shows. So there has to be a voice for God's word with regards to what truly people are dealing with in the paranormal.
Yep. Amen, Joe. And you know, when you think about, you know, just where we've come to, you know, we started out, I think back to 2010, we started out talking about Ouija boards and the dangers of those, and you know, trying to contact the dead. And you know, we transitioned into the ghost deception, and then into the alien deception, and then, you know, I mean, those are the areas where, you know, the voices, as you say, are so loud today.
That's right.
You know, you brought up a little while ago, I remember, in an email where you were saying that, you know, that you believe that a false flag of alien... the alien deception was on the horizon, and you know, that's another
yep.
area that we'll have to get back into. And you know, it's all these voices, as you say, Joe, for the devil that that have the loudest echo right.
That's
now.
Right.
And
yeah.
You know, we have the truth. Yeah, you know, we have God's word to lean on, and it's only God's word that changes lives. So,
yes.
You know, we need to dispel those loud voices with the truth of God's word. And Joe, I know it's true for you and for myself, that as long as we have breath in our lungs, this is where our focus is going to be. It's going to be on leading people out of darkness to light through the Word of God and through the power of the Gospel, because that is where the power is.
That's right, Bill. And, you know, we faced a lot of opposition along the way, some serious trials, I mean, big-time trials. You just went through, that Dana mentioned, in the last year.
Mm-hmm.
But as you said, Bill, as long as we have breath in our lungs, we've been called to this, and this is what we're going to do until... You know, the Lord calls us home. And understanding that we don't have the biggest stage, that's okay. You know, we know how the Lord works.
Yeah.
The Lord works in powerful, powerful ways, and we can't always see how he's working. We just trust that he is working. So he takes a program like tonight,
mm-hmm.
and X amount of people hear it, and then they tell other people about it, and then they tell other people... So, you know, we're so thankful that the Lord called us to this ministry, and we're thankful that we're still in it, and the battle is going to continue to rage, and we just need to be fighting at the front lines of this battle, and, you know, whatever we can do, we're going to do, and for our listeners, look, we're going to keep doing the research, we're going to keep getting guests, we're going to keep producing these programs, so... You know, Bill is the administrator of Answers for the Paranormal, and he handles all the Facebook and all the you know, I don't want to say publicity, but what's the word for publicity as far as what we do? Yeah. You handle all that, Bill. So, you know, Bill's on top of that. Keep checking. And as far as our next program, we're thinking about that round table. It could be something else. Who knows? But right. definitely at some point in the near future, we're gonna get Dana and Mark and Laura, the drafters of that open letter to Christian paranormal investigators, on for a roundtable discussion, because we want to get all of their insights as to what is really going on out there.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, because I'll tell you what, Bill, I don't know about you, but it was an odd thing for me to think about, well, wait a minute, Christian paranormal investigators? I mean, actually going on and, you know, we got into this ministry, and our website looks like we're paranormal investigators, mm-hmm. but we're not in the sense of the cultural understanding of it. We're yes. We're a couple of guys that come at it from the biblical perspective. So to hear that there are so many Christians getting drawn into this, it's fascinating to me, but it's disturbing. It's more disturbing to me than anything. So. Something we're going to have to try to keep our fingers on the pulse of why that's happening.
Yeah, I was not aware of it, and we definitely have to get our fingers on that.
Yeah, so we're going to do that, and, you know, thankfully we don't, as we've always said, though, this is the Lord's leading. He gives us information, He gives us direction, mm-hmm. His Spirit leads us. So we're trusting that, and we're looking forward to where He's going to bring us next.
Yeah, amen. All right, Joe, before we wrap up, why don't you give out our contact information, you know, how people can get in touch with Answers for the Paranormal.
Our website is www.answersfortheparanormal.org. And a little warning, advance warning, we have a page that's called the guest page. Mm. This will show you, if you go to that guest page, it'll show you how the devil works.
That's right.
He uses all of his servants to flood our guest page with all sorts of occultic messages from people that are talking about spellcasters who are improving their lives and witch doctors. Okay. You go to our guest page, you'll see how we are being attacked on that. So if people click on that page, they'll think, these guys say they're Christians? No, they're not. They're talking about the witch doctors and spellcasters
mm-hmm. yep.
and potions and all these, Dr. Mufasa and Dr. Mumbai. You know, it's not us. Those are people that post for the enemy yep. on our page.
Yeah, and we've even considered erasing all those, and you were like, no, leave them on there. Let everyone see what we're up against, you know? So I think that is...
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Every once in a while, I do an administrative response to all those the voodoo people. So, but anyway, again, it's www.answersfortheparanormal.org. And if anyone wants to email Bill or myself personally, Bill's is william@answersfortheparanormal.org. My email is joe@answersfortheparanormal.org. And boy, I'm telling you, we love to get emails, pro or con. We've yes. gotten them both. So if you have any questions, or if you have any comments on tonight's program, or any of the programs we've produced in the past that you've heard, please contact us and share with us your thoughts.
Yes. Absolutely, Joe. Well, thanks for tuning in tonight and listening to an interview with Dana Emanuel and an open letter to Christian paranormal investigators. Joe, I want to thank you again, and let's stay with it, brother, and let's get back on as soon as we can. Amen.
Amen, brother.
All right. Well, again, thanks for tonight, and we'll catch up with you next time on Answers for the Paranormal. Good night, Joe.
Good night, everybody. God bless.